Okay. I think we're good to get started. Yeah, Greg, you feel about that?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for today's webinar, our crash course on open data policies. We're going to start with just a brief introduction and an overview of what we hope to help you achieve in this webinar. Before we go any further, I do want to point out that we're going to be recording, or we are recording this webinar, and we're going to be making a link available to everyone who's attending so you can kind of share it with colleagues and coworkers who may be interested but weren't able to attend. So my name is Owen O'Malley. I'm the Open Cities Team Coordinator and City Support Specialist with What Works Cities.
Hi, my name is Greg Jordan-Dedamore, and I'm the Open Cities Strategy and Design Lead.
So our goals for this webinar, let's just review them just to kick things off. So our team has helped more than 60 US cities craft and implement their open data policies. So in this webinar, we're going to be guiding you through the process of generating your own open data policy. We'll go over best practices, review existing policies, and discuss how you can engage the public in the policymaking process. By the end of the webinar, you should have an understanding of the fundamentals of open data policies, and you should be well equipped to go off and start making or start drafting or making revisions to your own policy. And at the end of the webinar, we're also going to be showing you a tool that our team developed, which you can use to generate a draft version of a policy for your city, which comprises all the best practices that we're going to be covering during this webinar. Additionally, for folks attending this webinar who do go through that process of either generating or starting from scratch, drafting your own open data policy, we're going to be holding follow-up small group discussions in the coming weeks. These follow-up sessions are going to provide an opportunity for you to receive individualized feedback on your draft policies, as well as advice on getting these policies passed in your city. Or it can be an opportunity for a deeper dive on any of the topics that we covered today. We'll be following up over email with everyone who's registered today to provide instructions on how to join those sessions. Another thing we want to mention here at the top is What Works Cities certification. So this is the national standard of excellence for well-managed, data-driven local government. It is achieved by meeting a certain number of 45 criteria. If your city passes an open data policy that meets the best practices that we'll be outlining in this webinar, you can satisfy criterion OD1 of the certification standard. We also want to mention our open data policy hub. So this is a self-service resource that our team developed while working with US cities over the past 5 years. It provides sort of like a one-stop shop with all the resources that you'll need to create an open data policy for your city. We're gonna be referencing it periodically during the webinar, and we'll be sharing a link to it and other resources once this webinar is concluded.
So I will dive in here. Before we discuss open data policies, we wanna recap quickly what some of the benefits of open data are more broadly. So open data has both external benefits for the public and internal benefits for city governments. External benefits include, on the next slide here, external benefits include government transparency and accountability, access to information to empower community decision-making, and access to information about services. Internal benefits can include better internal data sharing and less time spent fulfilling public records requests. Now, even if you're interested in open data, you may still be wondering why it's important to have an open data policy specifically. And so public policy is essential because it demonstrates public commitment to lasting change. When a city creates an open data policy, they establish formal governance processes to make public data sharing institutional and sustainable. Open data policies can help cities with a variety of things, including establishing what data should be kept public or private, building public trust by demonstrating the city's commitment to lasting transparency and accountability, and engaging residents in a conversation about what open data they would like to see. We believe that a well-crafted open data policy is the foundation of robust open data practice. And now let's look at a case study from one specific city.
So this is Little Rock, Arkansas. It's one of our success stories from our early work in helping cities craft and pass policies. Little Rock worked with us in 2015 and 2016 and adopted their open data policy in 2016. And among other things, it established the role of performance and innovation coordinator to be the city's open data steward. This role is currently held by Melissa Bridges. We're going to share with you an article that the Ash Center at Harvard Kennedy School published about Melissa that details all the amazing work that her team has been able to do as a result of Little Rock passing their open data policy. Core to her team's many successes is their policy's mandate to centralize and standardize data across departments with the aim of publishing that data proactively. So we'd love to hear from the audience about what your goals and motivations are for passing an open data policy for joining this webinar today. So feel free to unmute yourself and share with us if you'd like.
Well, I could begin. My name is... I work at the State Library. I'm a government documents, government... publications, librarian and archivist, and I manage a statewide depository library program. We work with public libraries to provide permanent public access to state government information, but we have a lot of interaction with local governments, a lot of cooperation, and so I'm very interested in kind of helping become the first in our state to have an open data policy, and I see a direct tie with public library work and also state government publications. That's it for now.
That's great. Thank you.
Hi, this and a couple of things that we want to do is provide data that is accessible 24/7. So basically they don't have to go City Hall to get it. And also to kind of bypass the Freedom of Information Act to get process to get access to data or information. Right now we are trying to get an inventory and we're working with our city attorney to identify some of the commonly requested data and basically put it out in our open data portal so that it is more accessible and that requires less staff time and resources invested in gathering information for each FOIA request. So that's one thing that we're looking at doing.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I've got a quick question for you. Does your department track how much time you spend fulfilling those requests?
Whenever a request comes in, we give an estimate of the time and the materials that would require. And we also identify who the lowest paid individual that is capable of doing it. So basically that is identified in the process.
Yeah, that's great to know. Yeah, thanks. Also, I find your background very calming. So thank you for that. And we got a bunch of folks on, but let's, if other people want to share in the chat box, we'd love to hear your motivations, but at this point, let's move on with our presentation.
So now we want to discuss the content of open data policies. There are a few best practices that we want to highlight for inclusion in your open data policy. So one of them is to create a governance structure for the proactive release of public information. So this includes things like designating somebody as being in charge of the open data program, as well as many cities will create some sort of committee that has people from a number of different departments. So they may assign, for example, a departmental data coordinator who can help coordinate that each department's participation in the open data program as a whole. So having clear structures about sort of who's in charge and governance is very important. Great. Another is to include plans to collect regular public input on the open data program. And there's a few reasons for this. One is that in many cities, you know, the open data program, if you're passing an open data policy, it may be for the first time. And so the program itself may be new or fairly new. And so there are just things that you're going to learn. It's, you know, it's going to need to evolve. And so it's important to collect public input as it does evolve. Some policies will explicitly also say, for example, that there should be some sort of report after half a year or a year on how the program has been going so far. So yeah, collecting public input is very important. Another, actually I sort of just touched on this, but ensuring periodic review of policy language and implementation practice through at least annual reporting. So that ties right back in with the same idea that things are going to evolve, needs are going to change, new things are going to be discovered. And so it's important to sort of have a public facing, to have something public facing about all of this and about how things are going. And you know, annual reporting does not have to be a, you know, 500 page mega report, but just something to say how things have been progressing. Now, early on in the webinar, Owen mentioned What Works City certification. So just to circle back to that quickly, we mentioned that passing an open data policy will help you make progress toward certification. And specifically, if you pass a policy that meets at least three of these four criteria, these four best practices that I just mentioned, that means you will meet criterion OD1 for What Works City certification. And so OD1 is your local government has a publicly available codified open data policy that commits to data transparency and proactive disclosure of local government data and data practices. And as a reminder, those four guidelines that I just mentioned are creating a governance structure for the proactive release of public information, including plans to collect regular public input on the open data program, ensuring periodic review of policy language and implementation practice through at least annual reporting, and committing to public disclosure of decision-making pertaining to a number of things listed here. There are a few additional best practices that we want to highlight. These include referencing and building on existing public accountability and access policies. So many of, or presumably, is my Zoom frozen? Nope, we're good, okay. You all have some sort of public records policies in your states at least, whether you call it FOIA or something else. And so in many ways, open data is just building on top of that, on the idea that, you know, this information is public and that we want to enable public access to that. So that's one. Another is appropriately safeguarding sensitive information. So we, of course, you know, if we're opening data, we want to make sure that we're not opening confidential or private data, both because it should not be opened, and in many cases legally shouldn't be open, legally can't be opened. And also because it's critical, if you want an open data program to have public support, it's critical that people understand that we're not trying to open private data. Another is mandating data formats for maximal technical access. So you want to make sure that to the greatest extent possible, that data is being released in machine readable formats, preferably non-proprietary data formats. That allow it to more easily be used for different applications, whether that's someone doing data analysis, someone who's building some piece of software on top of it, you know, any number of things. So you don't, for example, want to be releasing data tables as scanned images in a PDF. Another good best practice is publishing bulk data. So having data available, not just, you know, where you can click and view different things online, but where you can download the data itself. And then another is mandating ongoing data publication and updates. So a lot of data, it's really important for it to be up to date, because a two-year-old version of the data set is pretty stale and not necessarily helpful today. So it's important that data sets be updated as frequently as possible and as frequently as makes sense for that data set. And different data sets will have different sensible update frequencies, but you just want to make sure that they are being updated on a frequency that is good and makes sense. If anyone has any questions I just threw a lot of information at you. If you have any questions, please feel free to pop them in the Zoom chat.
And over the work of the 5 years that our team has been doing this work with cities, we've compiled a larger list of 31 of these best practices, which are collectively called our open data policy guidelines. They cover what data should be made public, how it should be made public, and how the open data policy should be implemented. And we've been developing this, we've started developing this collection of guidelines during our earliest work with cities, as I said, about 5 years ago. And we've been using them extensively in our work with cities as part of the What Works Cities initiative, and they've influenced the development of numerous other policies. You can find the full list of open data policy guidelines at the link that's shown, which again, we're going to be sharing with everyone after the webinar. And you can see this is actually a screenshot from our open data policy hub. We're going to be sharing a link to that. And this is where you'll find the open data policy guidelines collected. It looks like we do have a question in the chat here from, what are good ways to address equity and accessibility for a population that may not have access to technology?
That is a great one. I think one of the best avenues for that would be partnerships with libraries, since they almost always have computers available. Many libraries also have programs of lending out Wi-Fi hotspots for people who may have electronic devices but no internet access. If your library doesn't have that, it'd certainly be a great program for them to start. But yeah, I think libraries are probably one of the best places for people for computer access if they don't have it. And so thinking about sort of partnering with local libraries when it comes to access to open data, I think is, that's something on that front. There's another question here. Have many success stories you worked with ended up creating a CDO group, or were smaller cities able to keep both within IT under a CIO? So I think, let's see here. We've seen a lot of different structures. A lot of different cities do things a different way. Some will have open data programs that are run entirely out of an IT department. Some will have open data programs that are run entirely out of, let's say, a performance analytics office or a budget and performance office. Occasionally we'll see at other places like communications. Some cities will do a partnership between different ones. So for example, in New York City, it's a partnership primarily between the mayor's office of data analytics and the city's IT department. So in that case, the IT department handles more of the technical side, and the mayor's office of data analytics handles more of the program side as well as public engagement. I think it really kind of depends. I think this is really one of those things when I was talking earlier about how open data programs will evolve. I think it's sort of something where you can try a structure, and if it seems like it's not working, you can evolve your structure into something different. And try out different possibilities. I hope that answers the question. For either of those two questions I just answered, if that does not answer your question, feel free to pop in the chat again. And for those of you who are considering taking advantage of our follow-up small group discussions, we strongly encourage you to review the open data policy guidelines and use them to generate questions or ideas that we can discuss in more detail. So now we are moving on. There are a number of different legal methods that you can use to enact your policy, and I'll explain the pros and cons of them. So common examples include a council resolution, an executive order, an administrative policy, and legislation. And each one has its advantages and disadvantages. The largest dichotomy would probably be between legislation and everything else. Legislation like New York City's open data law can be more powerful because it carries the force of law, but going through a full legislative process to get there in many cases takes longer and is more cumbersome than the other methods. And it may also be harder to fix if you made some oversight or mistake. If you have an elected strong mayor, executive orders can be a quick way of implementing a policy and a way of signaling executive support. However, we've definitely also seen cities where department heads don't necessarily always feel the heat from executive orders. Another big thing to remember is that they are often strongly associated with specific mayors, and so if there's a change of administration, they may not matter as much. Council resolutions share a lot of the advantages and disadvantages of executive orders, although they're less tied to specific personalities and executive turnover. It's unlikely that there's going to be an election and every seat on the city council changes. So if you have, and we've certainly seen a lot of cities that pass an open data council resolution that's unanimous, even if there's an election, that's still probably going to be the sentiment of the council more or less. And so it may have a little bit more staying power. And then finally, administrative policies, and they may go by any number of different names in your cities, but what we basically mean is anything that is created within the bureaucracy that's, you know, not one of those other forms involving elected officials, usually don't have to go through as many formalities. And they also often contain more implementation details than the other methods. But because they're a product of internal city staff and not elected officials, that can have an impact on whether or not other city staff feel like they need to be followed or the extent that they need to be followed. We want to mention that one option is to do several of these methods. So for example, some cities will first pass a broad council resolution or executive order and then follow it with a more detailed internal administrative policy. Also, some cities may start out with one or more of those things and then eventually pass legislation once they've had a chance to see the program in practice and revise it. So for example, in 2016, Seattle created a pair of policies together. One was a mayor's executive order, and one was a chief technology officer administrative policy. Also, in August 2016, Sioux Falls passed a council resolution that provided general objectives and direction for the open data program, and that then directed the city manager to figure out the details. And then several months later, in January 2017, the city passed a more detailed administrative regulation. Another key factor here is what type of government your city has, such as, you know, as I mentioned, a council manager system or a strong mayor system, as well as just the general culture in your government around these types of issues. So there are different solutions that might work best for different places. We certainly do want you to think about that possibility that I mentioned of having a council resolution or executive order paired with a more nuanced administrative policy. And then once the policy is in place and you've had time to look at it and revise it, you may want to pursue legislation in the future. So that's one possibility, but again, you know, think about what works best for your city. If anyone has any questions about what I just said, feel free to put those in the Zoom chat again.
And actually just catching up on, there's a lot of questions in the chat, which is great. Thanks everybody for dropping questions in there. I see there's two quasi-related questions here. One's from any tips for encouraging local government to support an open data program? And then I see that also asked if there's any kind of a template for working with your city manager, mayor, or council to ask them to consider adopting an open data policy. I don't know if we have such a template, but that's a great idea. Greg, I don't know if you have any other general tips for encouraging the adoption of open data programs.
Yeah, I think we'll discuss a bit more again later our open data policy hub. On there, if you go to our step-by-step guide for passing open data policy, I think it's like the first or second step talks about justifications for it. And so you can see different justifications that people have come up with about helping to convince others in government, or if you're outside of government, those in government, reasons why they should pursue open data and open data policy. We don't have a specific template per se of like a letter to send them, but hopefully that's helpful. Had a question. Do you have any examples of open data programs that operate on a regional level in partnership with multiple cities, or are they usually on a city by city basis? That is a fantastic question. I think most of the ones we've seen are city by city. There are a few that are not. One of my favorites, Owen mentioned here, the Western Pennsylvania Regional Data Center. Another one actually on the other side of Pennsylvania is in Philadelphia. Open Data Philly, so this is sort of an interesting thing. The city government has an open data program and a person who coordinates that. However, the open data portal is actually a regional one. It's hosted out of Temple University. And so there are a few different jurisdictions as well as special purpose districts that contribute data to that one common portal. I've definitely have seen a couple other cities who basically will let their open data portal be used by some special purpose districts or other agencies. So like some cities may let a transit authority that is not officially part of the city government put their data on there, or, you know, let's say a water sewer authority, things like that. So I've definitely seen joint portal efforts.
Cool. Thanks for your questions, everyone. So moving forward in the presentation, now that we've gotten a good idea of how to craft an open data policy and some of the more important things that it should include, let's talk about what to do once you have a working draft of a policy. We strongly suggest that cities seek public feedback on your draft open policy, even if it's an executive order or an administrative policy. Engaging the public in the policy crafting process as early as possible has many benefits. It can help you build the public's trust in your government from the very beginning of an open data program. It can also help spread the word about efforts the city is making towards data openness. And it can help residents better understand the ways in which your city is committed to transparency. And finally, it helps ensure that your policy is designed with your residents' needs in mind. There's those benefits right there. So there's a few different options for going about this. One sort of easy lift away is to post the draft policy as a cloud document using something like Google Docs or OneDrive or SharePoint, and allowing community members to comment on it, so setting permissions for comments. In this example from Boston, you can see that people commented on various individual pieces of policy language, providing suggestions for rewording, additional specificity, or additional considerations. And in this example from Pittsburgh, you can see people commenting on each other's comments, engaging in this sort of early discussion about the policy. So perhaps you're able to use Google Docs or OneDrive, or it's possible also that your city may have some other platform that it can use for soliciting public comment. So a number of US cities in the What Works Cities initiative have done this sort of crowd law, as it's sometimes called. Our team has maintained a list of some of these examples of cities and links to their draft policies with community comments on them, So if you're interested in seeing more of these examples, this tracker is linked to from the Open Data Policy Hub, which we continuously referenced. We're also going to share a direct link to this list after the webinar. And just some last points on getting community feedback in your draft policy or on your draft policy. In addition to helping you ensure that your policy is responsive to community's needs, gathering feedback on the draft policy can help you identify your open data stakeholders at the very beginning of your open data program. The people who get involved in this stage are going to be or can become the champions of your open data program and your connection to the larger data and civic tech communities in your city. And another point that we want to highlight right now is that even if you haven't drafted a policy yet, if you are interested in doing this kind of public feedback, this crowd law process, it's going to be really important to check with others in your government to make sure that they are also okay with doing it. You want to uncover and address any potential obstacles or resistance before engaging in this kind of public facing process. So any questions about this sort of crowd law process or community engagement and draft policies, just feel free to drop it in the chat.
We know we've just thrown a lot of information at you, but don't worry. We have a website that offers a one-stop shop for creating an open data policy. Once again, it's the Open Data Policy Hub. And I just put a link to it in the Zoom chat and we'll send it out afterward as well. There are a few different resources to highlight within the Open Data Policy Hub. There's a step-by-step, we have a few screenshots here.
I can also actually, Greg, is this a good time to show the live website? And I
can... Yeah, we can do the demo now.
So is everybody seeing the Welcome to the Open Data Policy Hub?
Great. So this is the homepage. So if we scroll down here, there are four key resources to highlight: Open Data Policy Step-by-Step, Open Data Policy Generator, Open Data Policy Guidelines, Open Data Policy Collection. So we can start with the step-by-step. So here, if you just scroll down, there's all sorts of different resources, guidance and resources available.
Yeah, some more in-depth details about building that buy-in internally in your city as well.
And then if you go up to the top, or there's links in the bottom too, to the collection. So the Open Data Policy Collection has over 140 total policies from over 100 cities and some states as well. So you can click on them on the map. You can have an alphabetical list by place name, list by date of adoption, however you want to find them. And then we also have
Sorry, Greg, which one are we going to?
There, unfortunately, there are no barking dogs on the website, but our Open Data Policy Guidelines are, this is that list of 31 guidelines that we mentioned. Each one, if you click on it, you'll see more details about it.
Yeah, and again, this collects, like, you know, our team's 5 years of working with cities to help craft and pass policy. So it's there's a lot of detail to go through in this hub.
And then our Open Data Policy Generator is basically, it takes our sample open data policy, which incorporates all of these best practices, and it's sort of like Mad Libs. You just put in a few things about your city, and then it will email you a draft open data policy that takes that sample open data policy, inserts these things in there, and actually it'll email it to you both in the text of the email, but also as a Google Doc if you want to just kind of dig right in. So that's kind of like an easy starting point where you can do that and then, you know, read through everything and think through, you know, does this work for us? Does this work for us? What do we want to change or the things we want to add? Things like that. Because I know for a lot of cities, it's kind of overwhelming figuring out where to start. It's like, okay, you've got these guidelines, yada, 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 all that stuff is great, but where do I start? And so this is a really easy way for you to start. And again, we will send you an email with links to these things, but it's all, those are all together on the Open Data Policy Hub. And we're also gonna send out a follow-up survey for the webinar. We, in the coming weeks, plan to host small group discussions for those of you who go ahead and create a draft open data policy. And this should provide an opportunity for peer learning as well as more individualized feedback from us. So that concludes the content of our webinar. Now we'd like to open it up for any questions that you may have. So feel free to just post them in the Zoom chat window and we will gladly answer them.
Actually, I'd say at this point too, I think we're caught up on the questions that are in the chat so far. So if folks want to just unmute themselves and ask at this point too, that'll work.
What have you seen in terms of timeline to implement and then achieve really OD1 certification?
So in terms of timing, yeah, I mean, it's honestly, it really depends on how long it takes to pass an open data policy, which in turn depends kind of on which of these methods you choose. I mean, there are some who may, you know, pass it in less than a month, especially if it's like an internal administrative policy. I've seen cities where they were having the council vote on something and it kind of months went by before the vote finally took place. So I'd say, yeah, the real question is like, how long does it take to get it like officially passed? The drafting process for a lot of cities, it may take a few weeks. A lot of times, you know, you want to run it by lawyers, that can sometimes have complicated results. As we mentioned, you know, it's great to get public feedback. So this question of how long you want it to be open for that, getting feedback from other departments since it's affecting them is very important. So I'd say, you know, in terms of dealing with those different internal and external stakeholders, the, you know, getting it from a very first draft to what you think is good, probably at least a month, could be longer. So at least a month. And if there are delays on the official passage side, could be several months.
Thank you very much.
Asked, my department directors will ask why. How does this benefit the city and my department? What justifies the cost if the public isn't asking for it now? That is an excellent question. And definitely one of the challenges is that there are these various public benefits, but a lot of ways in which the public may benefit from this may not be things that they're necessarily clamoring for right now, but that if and when the data is available, it's certainly will be clear why it was helpful. So for example, people once upon a time when transit information wasn't easily accessible on Google Maps or other platforms, you know, you may not necessarily have had a loud chorus of people saying, we need this here, but now that it is available, it's I think pretty obvious to everyone how useful that is. But the internal question, back to that, is definitely, I think there's a few things. I mentioned earlier in terms of the internal benefits of open data, two big selling points are often A, reduction in workload dealing with public records requests, and B, easier internal data sharing. So on the public records request side, and this will really kind of vary by department, some departments probably get a large number, and if some portion of those are for things, are for types of information that can be made proactively public, it can save people a lot of time. It can save departmental staff a lot of time. So I think that's a big selling point because it means that those staff can now do other things that they and department heads would probably rather they be doing. And on the FOIA side, what was the other side? Easier internal data sharing. So this is, again, it's like, it's tough because it's like, it's not for yourself, it's to help the other departments, but if all the departments do it, it helps each other. We've seen in a lot of cities where the process of getting data from another department, like theoretically you're part of the same government, but wow, it can be sometimes quite a headache. And so what we'll hear in a lot of cities is that some staff now have an easier time getting data from other internal departments now that it's just up publicly than they did back before when they had to call somebody, email somebody, whatever, and who knows how long it might take. So again, that depends on departments mutually doing it to help each other, but there's that. And it, actually, just like public records requests, it does mean that departmental staff can hopefully field fewer requests from other departments for that information. So those are a few internal selling points.
Yeah, and I would also add, you know, I think the point that made earlier, mentioning that, you know, his department does track, you know, as part of the FOIA response process, estimates of how much time and how much is it going to cost to answer all those things. So if you have those numbers handy, that's a great way to build the argument for, you know, especially if you're trying to get buy-in from people who are particularly budget-minded.
And actually another point, so this was a kind of public-facing benefit is on the transparency and accountability side of things. The way that can circle back to being an internal benefit is that various departments, for any number of reasons, may sometimes have challenges when it comes to public engagement, public feelings about the department, you know, a number of things. There might be people who feel like the department's not being transparent enough or who are, you know, any number of things. And so it can provide a way to better relate to the community, let's suppose, for example, people have a perception that streets in a certain part of the city aren't being repaved or that things aren't getting fixed in a timely manner. If you have data that shows otherwise, it can be very helpful to put that out there so that people have that. Because in a lot of cases, people just don't, you know, all you can really see is what you see with your eyes if you don't have access to any other information. So it may be helpful on sort of a communications and public relations front as well. I see you also asked, does the hub have samples of data to publish? No. That was an easy answer. I'd say the best source is really just looking at other cities' open data portals or websites to see the data that they've published. So if there are no other questions, that concludes our webinar. Thank you. Have a great afternoon. Look out for our follow-up email. And certainly if you have additional questions, you can email us. And yeah, we hope to see many of you in follow-up small group discussions.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks again for everybody for joining today and for asking questions. It's great questions today.
Thank you.